been about loving Jesus and making him known. If you're a guest with us here today, we are so excited that you are here. If you would, grab a card in the seat back in front of you, fill it out, and after service, take it out to our connections table out in our lobby where there are going to be some awesome people excited to meet you and give you a special gift just for coming today. Now, let's check out the top three here at OC.
Number one.
Wednesday nights at One Church is the place to be with services for all ages. For pre-K through fifth grade, we have our One Kids Amped service. For students 6th through 12th grade, we have our OC Students service. And for adults, we have Deeper right here in the sanctuary. Come join us this Wednesday night from 6:30 to 8 p.m.
Number two.
Here at One Church, we believe that it's God's desire for no one to walk alone. So we want to help you get plugged into community. If you're ready to get plugged in, then it is time for you to get signed up for One Church Plugged In. At Plugged In, they will go over a few things about our church as well as talk about several of our awesome ministries that you can get plugged into and serve. This is an awesome first step in becoming a One Churcher. Also, you need to check out one of our awesome life groups called B Groups. To get more info about our B Groups, check the box that says Join a Life Group and bring that card to our connections table here in the lobby after service where they will help you get plugged in.
Number three.
If you have recently made the decision to make Jesus the Lord of your life, we want to strongly encourage you to visit our Next Steps table here in the lobby where we have some awesome leaders that want to talk to you and give you resources to help you in your walk with Jesus. As always, here at One Church, there are a few ways that you can give. In person in the boxes by the doors, in mail, by text, or online at www.onechurchwhitesboro.org. That's it for announcements. Now let's get up on our feet and prepare to worship.
Good morning, One Church. I'm so excited to be back. Jesus, we love you so much this morning. You are the good one. You are the faithful one, the holy one, the one deserving of celebration and praise. The one we want to host this morning, the one we want to see and talk to and know. We love you. I choose this day to be grateful, Lord. I give you praise with an open heart. I'm waking up to heaven. I'm waking up to you. I choose this day. I choose this day. I'm waking up to you.
Oh, darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Says it's like a vapor. It comes and it goes so fast. We only have just this much time to praise Him, even in the contradiction. There will never be in heaven a contradiction like there is a contradiction today. You understand what I'm saying? Like there's a thing I see over here, then there's the truth of what God says. And sometimes what I see in this world does not match what I know He says. And the opportunity to praise Him in the contradiction, in the tension of that time, we only get it now. We only have this while we have breath. We only get this shot right here. So I just want us to declare that He is faithful. And that we will praise Him, especially in the contradiction. Amen. Amen. Sing all my life. And all my life you have been faithful. Oh, you good God. And all my life you have been so, so. Goodness. Hey, we're gonna sing it again, all my life, yeah. And all
goodness of God.
I shared something with the team this morning that I wanted to share with all of you. In one of my classes this week, we were talking about the word gospel. And we, in the church, understand that word to mean good news, right? It's what the angels come down and tell the shepherds, behold, I give you great tidings of good news and joy. And then Paul later on says, you know, let your feet be shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace and good news. So we understand this thing that these four things that we have, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are these four accounts of good news that the Lord has saved, really has saved humanity. But the Greek word for gospel is evangelion or euangelion, something like that. And it actually means good news from the battlefield. That's the fullness of it. So the idea of it, like I was sharing this morning, I love Camelot, so picture Camelot with King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table and Guinevere and Lancelot and the whole thing, right? So King Arthur has developed and created peace in this place called Camelot. And he did it through the Knights of the Round Table. And so, of course, there's a whole problem that ensues with Guinevere and Lancelot and all these things happen. But at the very end, at least in the play version, there's this little boy that that King Arthur comes across. And it's at the end and it's after everything's happened. And he comes across this little boy, and he's hiding in a basket or a pantry or under a rock or something. And he finds this little boy, and the boy comes up to him, and King Arthur wants to know who he is. And the boy says, oh, you know, sir, all I want to be is a knight in your armor. I only want to be a knight at your round table. And that's all he wants to be when he grows up. And King Arthur is so moved by this little boy's intentions and what he wants to do when he grows up, and he knows the peace that was available at Camelot. So King Arthur charges this boy with going from village to village to village, telling everyone in each village what King Arthur did at Camelot and the peace that was possible. And so the same applies to us now, because the word gospel, good news from the battlefield, it's that we would go from village to village telling who won for us. Saying, I was there. I saw at the battlefield in my own heart and in my life, in the landscape of my life, in the trenches and on the top of the mountain, I saw who won. And he won for me. And he made it so that peace is available in my life. Good news from the battlefield. Victory is his.
Our fight is with weapons unseen. Your enemies crash to their knees as we rise up in worship. When trials unleash like a flood, the battle begins. Belongs to our God as we cry out in worship. The victory is yours, you're riding on the storm. Your name is unfailing, though the kingdoms rise and fall. Your throne withstands it all. Your name is unshaken.
What helmet?
What helmet to break me has failed. Now nothing can silence my praise. I will cry out in words. Walls of the prison will shake. The chain-breaking King will rise to save as we cry out in worship. Oh, 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 oh. The
though the kingdoms rise and fall, your throne we stand immortal. Your name is unshaken. It's unshaken.
Just one more time, but I want to emphasize something. Like Penny said, the victory is yours. You're riding on the storm. Think about that picture, that the storm that we're experiencing, you know, we're below the stratosphere and we see the rain coming at us, but if we were to see it above, that would be the thing the Lord sits on. That's what brings him into our circumstances, right? That he's on the other side of the thing that makes it look chaotic and hopeless to us, the thing that makes it look dark and gloomy and hopeless. And he's riding on that thing. The way that he uses that to bring faith and hope and goodness in our life. So whatever that in your life that does not align with the truth of God, remind it that he rides on its back, that he comes right before it. And right after it, that his glory is your rear guard.
The victory is yours, you're riding on the storm.
Your name is unfailing. Your victory is yours. You're riding on my storm. Your name is unfailing. The victory is yours. You're riding on my storm. We know you to be so good and so worthy of worship. We know you as faithful and true. The one who is worthy of worship, the one who is to be celebrated and honored. You are the faithful one, Jesus. We know the end of the story and how you win every time. I know the end of my story and how you win in my story too. You are good, and we love you. Amen.
Good morning, One Church. That's called a hot mic right there. How's it going? Anybody? All right. Everybody good today? So glad you came to church today. Hey, a couple things real quick before we get started. I know it is not too late to still sign up to be a part of the women's retreat. You're going to want to do that as soon as church is over today. If you've not had a chance to sign up, go out there in the lobby and get signed up with that. It's going to be absolutely incredible. Second thing, for those of you that are around yesterday, you probably couldn't help but notice that there's this thing called a trunk or treat going on here at the church. So absolutely awesome. I'm not gonna lie, man. I had some doubts. Like when I walked outside and I just felt the weather and it was like nasty and rainy and all that. Like I thought to myself, it's like, oh man, I wonder if people are gonna show up. Guess what? People showed up. Like so much so that we actually had to go on a candy run. We weren't expecting that. Like on a candy run, there were so many kids, and there was. By the way, there's some of you in this room right now that you know exactly where the candy went because your children had pillowcases full of candy, and so listen, you reap what you sow. I'm just gonna say it right there. What it is, it's getting ready to happen. But no, we're so thankful to our team. To Amy and Tiffany for and all the team from our children's ministry, helping put that thing together is just a practical way for us to reach out and love on the community and get them hyped up on sugar. And so we did. But what I want to do right now is if you were a part of helping us pull that off, whether you did a trunk or you did the games or you helped in childcare or you helped decorate or any of those things, if you were a part of Trunk or Treat, I want you to stand up right now. If you'd stand up for me right now, and let's celebrate these individuals. Come on. Be a part. It was awesome. It was awesome. So good, so good. So every year we do the, I call it the Junk in the Trunk Award. But it's for what was voted as the best trunk this year, and I know the suspense has to be, you know, killing us all. Because that's what you really came for this morning, is to find out who brought this bad boy home. No, not necessarily. But there are lots of awesome trunks yesterday. And we're going to, in fact, we had our OC students that have their own trunk award that's going to be given out Wednesday, because there were some awesome ones that our youth did as well. But I just want to announce that this year, the 2002 One Church Junk in the Trunk Award goes. Can we get a drum roll or something like a, I mean, whatever, you know, so joy to the world. Okay, sorry, this is a Christmas movie. It's getting ready. Let's give it up. Here we go. For Austin and Jess Miles. Austin and Jess. Are the Miles here? Where are the Miles? Miles? Okay, Miles are not here today. Duly noted. Should you have to be present to win? No, okay, so we'll go ahead and put that down right there. No, it was absolutely incredible. Thank you so much for everybody that was a part of that. And Rusty and Penny are walking up here. So yes, ma'am.
It's always a little unnerving to him when people just show up. Do you see that? He's like looking. Yeah.
This isn't a business meeting, right?
No.
Okay, so.
So, the month of October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and so we just, and if you didn't notice it in the foyer, tomorrow is Pastor Will's birthday, so hallelujah, yes, yeah. And so we just wanted to honor him this morning. And for those of you that don't have a view of his life, I just want to just give you a little snippet. And you'll understand why we just admire and appreciate him so much. He is a full-time teacher, and he is a full-time coach, and he is a full-time pastor, and he's a full-time husband and a full-time dad, and has a very busy life and a very full and wonderful life. But he makes sacrifices that none of us can comprehend, and we appreciate so much the sacrifices that you make, and on our behalf, on everyone's behalf. And we are so appreciative, and we are so appreciative of you, Brandy, that that you would share your husband with everybody. Yeah. Because I know that all of us see him, and we think we have a piece of him. And so that is only because you are so gracious and so willing to share him with all of us. And we appreciate that so much. Amen. Amen. Yeah. And so we want to give you and you a night away and a dinner at a spa or resort or wherever you choose to go. And I'm sure Richard would be happy to babysit the children overnight. So, surprise. Yeah, no. Just kidding. But we... on behalf of all of us at One Church, we love you and we appreciate you every Sunday. But today we just wanted to show you how much.
Thank you. if you ever struggle in life with this thought of am I enough? Anybody else ever deal with that? Yeah. Totally get it. Totally understand. This is such good timing because I carried my son into bed last night, and as I was walking, I just There are so many things that, you know, areas that God has spoken to me and to things that where I feel like He's called me, and I was just, it's like, Lord, I don't want to fail at any of these. And first and foremost, the most important to me, and listen, I love you guys, but obviously, and just in my the way that the Lord. The way that He just loves on me, and even though I know that I don't deserve it, none of us deserve it, but then second to that would be the way, I mean, I'm so glad Penny said it, because the way that my wife, and what she sacrifices, and what, thank you, sir, and what she does, it's just to enable me, to allow me to do this. And she's absolutely the most incredible wife in the world, the most incredible mom in the world, and I am so I just thank God that he gave me her, I'm so thankful that He gave y'all her, even though that you don't know her. And so, thanks a lot, Rusty and Penny. I really appreciate it. I love surprises. Okay. All right. Reset. Welcome to One Church. I'm Will. Man, did Rusty do an awesome job last week? I mean, if you were here last week, yeah, The Matrix made me want to go watch a movie from the 90s. I mean, I was way too young, of course, to watch it back then, seeing as I'm only turning 24 tomorrow. It was awesome stuff last week, and I'm so appreciative of Rusty and Penny and what they mean to me personally and what they mean to our church. But last week when I was kind of going through it a little bit and had so much stuff going on from ball tournaments and things and literally zero time to prep. The Lord knew all that, but I didn't realize it was going to be that way until last week. But the way that just knowing that just the calling that's on Rusty's life and how He's answered that call, like, we are incredibly blessed as a church to have him and to have Penny. And me as your pastor, I'm just going to say they're the other half of me as far as the ministry, the pastoral team. Just so blessed to have them. So it's Pastor Appreciation Week. I don't have anything. Okay. I didn't realize it was. Okay, so there's that. I should look at a calendar more often. So there we go. Let's get into this. So several weeks ago, we asked this question. We said, if you had to choose a picture to represent God, like, what would it be? Like, if you had a picture, if you picture God, what would it be? And again, we weren't talking about, like, the literally, like, the physical view of God. Like, some people have that, like, old man with the white flowing robe and the flowing beard going on. But rather, the picture that you would use to describe God. And so I've shared this quote every week. I'm going to share it again. But A.W. Tozer said it like this. He said, "We tend by a secret law of the soul to move toward our mental image of God." By the way, I leave that up there. I think the opposite of that is true as well. Like, so we tend by this secret law of the soul to move toward our mental image of God. But I also believe that the opposite is true, that if we have a faulty image of God, an image of God that's not accurate, then the enemy can use that to drive us away from the presence of the Lord in our lives. Out of fear, there's several tactics that can use. So we all have images of God, and I believe that some of our unbiblical perceptions of God have caused chaos and havoc in some of our lives and prevented us from living the abundant life that Jesus came to give us right now. And so that's kind of where we've been. And Paul actually discussed this with a group that had fallen into this trap in Romans chapter 1, and he lays all the symptoms, right? That's the symptoms of what had happened, but then he backs it up in verse 25 and gives what I believe is the root cause of all this in Romans 1:25, when he says they traded the truth about God for a lie. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Like they traded the truth about God for a lie. So for the past few weeks, we've been looking at different faulty pictures of God that I believe are prevalent in society today. We started off in week seven. I kind of jumped into this whole like Disney theme. Week seven, we looked at Aladdin and the genie in the bottle, and this view of like God as this exists to fulfill kind of my cosmic wish list, so to speak. And then week eight, we talked about the Little Mermaid and how her dad got, you know, super angry and, you know, shot lightning and stuff from his spear and all that. And that he's the angry, vengeful view of God that's ready to like lay the hammer every single time we fail. And some of us have dealt with that for sure. And then a couple weeks ago, we looked at Finding Nemo, and you remember this dad made those rules, and it was this overbearing parent. So sometimes we have this view of God like he's a cosmic killjoy, and there's nothing but this like list of rules like that we got to follow, and just trying to take all the fun around of it. We talked about how ridiculous that notion really is. But today we're going to look at one of my favorite top five. I'm going to put this in my top five. You can have your top five. This is mine. But my top five, one of my top five Disney movies, and it's The Lion King. I'm a fan of The Lion King. But before we do that, I want us to go. Everybody, I just heard like four people be like, oh, it's a cartoon, really? In Matthew, I'm going to go here first. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus asked his disciples what I think is the most important question that has ever been uttered in human history. Like the most important question, the most significant question. In fact, it's the single most important question that we ourselves today could ever answer in our own lives. And so I want to see if you catch it. We're going to go to Matthew 16 before we go to verses or the pictures of the Lion King. We're going to go to Matthew 16 and start in verse 13. It says this: when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Jesus said, but what do you say? What about you? He said, who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. Now, did you catch the question? Leave that up there. Did you catch it? Did you catch the question? Jesus asked the disciples, who do you say I am? Like, who do you say I am? There is no question that will ever be posed that has more significance to that question right there. Who is Jesus? Like who is Jesus? I know who he is. Like, I know who he is, and I know who he wants to be in your life. But listen, but every single person on earth must answer this question for themselves. So look, who is Jesus? And so I don't want to just keep flowing like right here. I want you to like who is Jesus? Like, who is he? Like, to you, like in your heart, and what do you believe? Like, what do you believe? What do you believe about Jesus? Like, who is Jesus? Listen, there's lots and lots of religions that recognize like Jesus, like he is a matter of historical fact. Like, so there's lots of views on this. Some say that he's a good teacher. Others say like a strong ethical person. Others say he's others say that he's a prophet. And by the way, like I would reject like those things. And here's why. Here's why. Like I reject those because, listen, Jesus, either he is who he says he is, or he is the craziest madman in the history of mankind. Period. Like, it's one of those two things. Because when you cannot say that if he is not Lord, if Jesus is not the Son of God, if he is not who he says that he was, then there have been millions upon millions of people who have died in his name. There's been millions of people that have been put to death because of their belief in Christ. In fact, it's estimated that between 90 to 100,000 Christians were killed last year for their belief in Christ. And so this notion that he would somehow be like some other religions have, that he would somehow be just this strong, moral, ethical, you know, teacher or prophet. Listen, no. He is either the Son of God or he's not. And so who is Jesus? Like we have to answer that question for ourselves. Who is Jesus? Is Jesus the Lord of your life? I don't know. I know for many of us, man, maybe we've been raised in a tradition of, I mean, you know, Jesus, yeah, I mean, Jesus, he, you know, the big guy in the sky, and you find yourself in church today, and listen, this question is kind of just smacking you in the forehead because you've never really thought about it in that context before, but is Jesus Lord? Like, is Jesus Lord? There is no question that will ever be posed to you that is more significant and more important than that question of who is Jesus? Is he the Lord of your life? And if he's not the Lord of your life, I know that he wants to be the Lord of your life. Like he literally died to be the Lord of your life, and then he raised again. And if you receive that, if you choose to believe that, if you believe, then the way we close service every single week here is by confessing. If we confess that with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, and we believe that, we believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead. Like you are now in Christ. You, as the Bible calls you, saved. But you are now in Christ. And now you have the abundant life that we've been talking about can be unleashed in your life through his presence. But you have to choose that. So the most important, the most significant question that we could ever answer is, who is Jesus? The second most important question I believe we could ever ask ourselves, and by the way, this is going to determine what type of life you really live here on earth. If the first question is, who is Jesus? The second question is, who does that make you? Who does that make you? What does that mean? What, like who does that make you? And so as we dive into this today, we're going to go there. We're going to talk about that. Before we go there, do I have any Lion King fans? Like, are there anybody else like me? Okay, so Lion King's outside the window, my meat's in my mouth. Okay, so okay, yeah, I'm a huge Lion King fan. So anybody not seen the movie? Like, before we continue, okay, so most everybody, or at least you just don't want to admit it. Today I've not seen the movie. Like, anybody planning on going to Blockbuster later and renting the movie? Like, anybody? Okay, I got some really bad news for you, bro. With that, so, by the way, hey guys, Blockbuster is literally, there was this video store, and what would happen is you would have to go, it's crazy, you literally have to get out of your car, you had to walk in, you had to go and look at the boxes, and if there's this box, and if the video was behind it, then you knew you could grab the video and go check it out. You'd literally have to rent it. It was crazy. You couldn't even TikTok it. Like, it was crazy. You couldn't be like, I'm renting a video. Like, there wasn't any of that back then. I know it's hard to understand. With that, I'll share more later. Okay, so. But no, I love the Lion King. I love the Lion King. The Lion King, if you're not familiar or you don't remember, the Lion King is a movie about the adventures of young Simba. There he is. Now we can, there he is. Okay, cartoon cat. Okay, yeah. His dad Mufasa was the king, right? And Simba was like next in line, right, to be the king whenever his dad passed away. But Simba's wicked uncle, this dude, his name was Scar. And so Scar plots to try to like take Mufasa's throne by like killing Mufasa and Simba, like to wipe them out, right, the lineage. And tries to lure them into this pack of wildebeests and kill them in a stampede of wildebeests, hoping that they both die. Well, so what ends up happening is Mufasa dies and Simba survives it with that. But then Scar then convinces Simba that it was his fault that his dad died and that he needed to go on the run. And in fact, if he didn't go on the run, then everybody was going to find out that he was the one that somehow killed his dad. And so he manipulates Simba into running away. And so now Simba goes on the run. And as he's out there on the run, this happens. So let's watch this.
Creepy little monkey. Will you stop following me? Who are you?
The question is, who are you? thought I knew. Now I'm not so sure.
Well, I know who you are. Shh, come here. It's a secret.
Enough already. What is that supposed to mean, anyway?
It means you're a baboon, and I'm not.
I think you're a little confused.
Wrong. I'm not the one who's confused. You don't even know who you are.
Oh, and I suppose you know.
Sure do. You're Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait! You knew my father?
Correction. I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope. Wrong again. He's alive. And I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki. He knows the way. Come on. Stop!
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No. How could I?
You have forgotten who you are, and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son, and the one true king.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
Don't leave me.
Remember.
What was that? The weather. Very peculiar, don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long. Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah! You see? So what are you going to do?
First, I'm gonna take your stick.
No! Not a stick! Hey! Where are you going?
I'm going back!
Good!
There is so much there. So good. So Simba's dad, you have forgotten who you are. You have forgotten who you are. You have forgotten me. You are so much more than you have become. Remember who you are. I believe Mufasa is preaching a sermon to somebody today. Because that's so good. He's preaching, and just like Simba, man, there's so many of us that I think that would fall in that category of being afraid to go back there, wherever there is. Like being afraid to go back there because it's going to bring back some painful things like from our past, or it's going to remind us of massive failure, maybe in our lives. But can I remind you this morning, though, that if you are in Christ, listen, your past is paid for. If you're in Christ, your past is paid for. Like, you don't have a past problem. Like, I don't care if your past was 5 years ago or 5 minutes ago. Like, you do not have a past problem. Jesus has already taken care of your past. If you are struggling with that this morning, then you have forgotten who you are. If we're still dealing with things in the past, we have forgotten who we are. See, the Apostle Paul had to be like haunted by his past. Like if we know the story of Paul, then we know that in his past, many he hunted and imprisoned and literally murdered Christians like for fun. Like it's what he did like on a Tuesday. Right? Like he imprisoned them and murdered them like for fun. And so this is what Paul says about his past in Philippians 3, starting verse 12. He says, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. He's talking about, so I press on to take hold of it, to be able to take hold of what? To take hold of what? What Christ Jesus has already taken hold of me. Like I'm trying to grasp this just how huge and his love is for me to try to grab a hold of. And I haven't figured it out yet, because if I figured it out, this is what I believe is, this is the New Will translation. If I had figured it out, man, it would change everything about like my current circumstance. Like if I could actually walk in how the Lord views me, it would change everything about my life. But I haven't figured it out yet. But there's one thing I know. There's one thing I know, this is what Paul tells us, there's one thing, like I haven't taken a hold of the magnitude of what Christ has done for me just yet and who he's made me just yet, but there's one thing I got to do, and he goes on, he says, I got to forget what is behind. I've got to forget what is behind. In other words, we have to stop letting what is behind us rob us of what God has put before us. We got to forget what is behind. Church, listen, have you made mistakes? Everybody say yes. Have you made mistakes? The answer is yes. But can I tell you that Jesus knew that before he signed up for this deal? Like he knew that long before he decided to embrace in this covenant, before he put a ring on it. Like he knew it. This is what Romans, in Romans chapter 6, Paul shows us who we were before grace shows up. And I don't have this verse up there, but because I kind of added to this late. But in Romans 6, verse 6, he explains it like this. Paul refers to us and he says that before Christ, we were slaves to sin. We were slaves to sin. There's in the Greek, this word slave to sin, it's one word. It's dulion. I think it's how you said dulion. I don't know. So, yes, that's what, okay. So they're the dulio, and it literally means to be a slave. It means to be a slave, to be. We talk about how to be here all the time here at One Church, to be. This means this was your identity. This is who you were. You were a slave to sin. That is your identity. That is what you identify with. This is who you be. You were a slave to sin. Now, here's my question. Do slaves have any say in their identity? The answer is no. The answer is no. Like, if you are a slave, you have no choice in the matter. You have no say whatsoever in your identity. Paul says we were slaves to sin. That was our identity, and there was nothing that we could do about it. Nothing. We were slaves to sin. That's who we were, and there's nothing that we could do about it. No, but wait a minute. What if I change, like would it change my identity as a slave to sin if I change my behavior? Like if I'm able to like behavior modification, would that change my identity as a slave to sin? Church, the answer is no. Like behavior modification does not change our identity as slaves to sin. But Paul goes on. Paul goes on to describe our identity now. So that's who we were. We were slaves to sin. But then Paul goes on in verse 17 to describe who we are in Christ now. This is what it says in verse 17. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were committed. This is talking about on the basis of faith. Because even, like, don't get it twisted, even though some of the terminology be like, you became obedient, be like, oh, you did something. No. You became obedient to the heart to a form of teaching. In other words, you chose to accept it and to believe it. To believe it by faith. That's what this is alluding to. If you don't believe me, read the rest of Romans. okay? Because it's all right there, but it says this, and having been freed from sin, here it is, you became what? You became slaves to what? Slaves to righteousness. You've been freed from sin, and you became slaves of righteousness. Now, when we apply those same rules, right? When we apply those same rules to the game, righteousness is now our identity. It's our identity. That's who we are. Just as changing our behavior would not change our identity as slaves to sin, in the same way, a change in behavior does not change your identity as slaves to righteousness. Why is that so important? Some of you didn't catch it. If you are in Christ, listen, you are the righteousness of God. That's who the Word of God says you are. If you are in Christ, then you are the righteousness of God. Listen, and there is nothing you can do to change it. Somebody need to hear that. There's nothing you can do to change it. Listen, a few verses earlier in Romans 6, in verse 4, this is what Paul says. It says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. We too may live a new life. So what new life is this talking about? I know we've discussed this before, but I want to make sure it's clear. Listen, this is not just talking about heaven when you die. That's secure. That's taken care of. That is final upon receiving Christ. It's not just talking about heaven. If you are in Christ, like, you're guaranteed the eternal life with Jesus, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to live the new abundant life right now. It says, look at the phrasing there again, that we may live a new life. So when we come to Christ, Jesus is giving us access to live a new life right now, but we have to choose it. Like, we have access, like, we have full access to this life right now, but we have to choose it. But the only way to choose it is by embracing your new identity. We have to embrace who it is that God says we are. One of the reasons that we don't experience new life right now is that we have to make a decision. I like to word it like this. We make a decision to stop hanging out with dead things. We need to stop letting like hanging out with dead things. And by the way, one of those dead things is your old identity. One of those dead things is that verse that we just read that says that we've been buried in death, that we've been raised with him through the glory of God. Listen, so that person is dead, but we wanna hang on to some of the rules that apply to that person. In other words, some of the dead things we're hanging out with is religion. And this view of, I'll get there in a minute, but let's go here first. I love this verse, and I love sharing this, but Luke chapter 24, verse 5, this is what the two angels that appeared before the women at the tomb, this is what it says. And in their fright, so these angels just appeared, it says, in their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? Why do you look for the living among the dead? Like many of us are living lives of frustration because we're looking for life in things that are dead. We look for life in things that are dead. We have to stop letting dead things, by the way, including religion, we have to stop letting dead things rob us from life, from being able to experience life and life more abundantly. Like how many of you would be willing to say, man, I got some dead things? Like, how many of you got some dead things that sometimes seem enticing? Like, anybody else? Come on. Like got some dead things? Yeah, some things that are sometimes kind of enticing. So listen, we all do. If you didn't raise your hand, your pants are on fire, okay? So, because we all do. There's some things that sometimes seem enticing. But we've got to stop letting the dead things like that you fell for in the past prevent you from walking in your divine purpose and calling. And here's what I want to make sure that all of us get this morning. This was power. At least this really spoke to me when the Holy Spirit shared this with me this week. You see, he said this. He said, "Will, your past does not exclude you from my presence or my promise. Your past does not exclude you from his presence or his promise." And I needed that. I needed that. Like he shared, like, and I'm not talking about, this wasn't like in Pastor Will's like pastoral study room that's in the Holy of Holies. That doesn't exist. But like, you know, sometimes pastors will say stuff, you know, like the Holy Spirit like shared this with me, and you think, oh man, he's, you know, oh, like this voice, you know, like I was, you know, through my 27th chapter of reading the Bible that day. Because that's what pastors do. Clearly, I judge all of you for not, but but we think of when we're talking about the Holy Spirit, listen, I alluded to it earlier, like I had picked up my son out of my bed and I was carrying him into his bed, and I had this thought, and I literally prayed, and I literally was like, God, I don't want to fail at this. I don't want to fail at being a dad. I don't fail at being a husband. I mean, the enemy has been kicking me like this week. I don't want to fail at that. This feeling of condemnation, which was not from the Lord. You know, the enemy, you know, just hammering me. And as I was placing like Trip down in his bed, and just wrestling with some of these things, it was like on my way back to my room that literally I sensed the Holy Spirit just say that to me, that Will, your past, like, listen, what's going on? It does not exclude you from my presence or my promise. I said, thank you, Lord. So I believe somebody need to hear this, that your past does not exclude you from his presence. Your past does not exclude you from his promise. See, John chapter 16 talks about how the, you know, the different roles of the Holy Spirit like in our lives, and one of those is to convince us of our righteousness. Like, to convince us of our righteousness, and I believe the Spirit of God is doing that right now with somebody, that you need to be convinced of your righteousness. You need to be convinced that you are who, in fact, God says that you are. And I believe the Holy Spirit's doing that right now. I want us to go to Galatians chapter 4, verse 3 here for the rest of our time. Just for the next couple of moments here. And in verse 3, it says this. This is Paul talking. He says, "So we too, when we were children, were held in bondage under the elementary principles of the world." Now, I want to stop right there. We were held in bondage to these principles of the world. Like, when we start thinking about the principles of the world, there's actually a lot of things that come to mind. Like, for me. But one of them that really hit me this morning is kind of this idea of what we call a debt-debtor relationship. Like, the world has a debt-debtor relationship. Like if you, for example, like you know, it's just the opposite of the golden rule. It's like, do unto others what they do to you. Except it needs to be a proportional response. Right? I mean, we have that in our military. Like, if another country does something to us, we are going to respond proportionally. We are going to remind them that, hey, we're the biggest, baddest Mamba Jahamba on earth. And so if you want to throw down, we will throw down, okay? So so there's these things called proportional response, you know, that happens. Well, that is absolutely a principle of this world. That's a principle of this world. And so by the way, that's also these principles of this world, it's where religion fits in really nicely. Because it becomes really easy to kind of differentiate and start to separate like the different rules, like, and things, depending on which game, you know, when you want to be playing along with this. But we were held in bondage under these principles of the world. And I would argue that some of those principles, if you are a religious person, can very easily trickle into your doctrine, which is why we have to watch our doctrine. The Bible literally instructs us to watch our doctrine closely, because we got to make sure that this doesn't happen, that these principles, these elementary principles trickle in. Because listen, we were held in bondage. Those principles will hold you in bondage. Let's keep going. We're held in the bondage under the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, so that he might redeem those who were under the law, under the rules. This is Jesus fulfilling the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons and daughters. This next verse is great. Verse 6, because you are sons. I want to stop right there. It says because, and then it gives later, because, here it is, because the one, because, I want you to notice what it doesn't say. It doesn't say because you are holy. It doesn't say because you are sanctified, because you are spiritually mature. It doesn't say that. It says very clearly, because you are what? Sons. Because you are sons. Okay, because you are sons, what happened? Because you're sons, what happened? What happened was God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Why? Why did that happen? Why did that happen? Because we are sons. It happened because we are sons. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a slave, then an heir through God. This is the evolution of our identity. I know that's a bad word, but I'm just saying church. But this is the evolution of I couldn't think of a better word. I'm sorry. Okay, don't judge me. Okay, so of your identity, you went from slave to adopted, to sonship, to indwelled by the very presence of God, to an heir. H-E-I-R. Big difference. To a joint heir. Raise your hand if you're in Christ this morning. That is your identity. That is your identity. That is an identity. You are sons and daughters of the King of Kings. You are a joint heir. You are indwelled by the very presence of God. And by the way, do you know what heirs get? Heirs get an inheritance. Heirs receive an inheritance. I had a teacher friend of mine just a couple of weeks ago. His great-grandmother passed away. He inherited $16 million. His wife and I, both teachers, they went from being broke to millionaires. Ask me if they went to work the next day. Nope. Okay, so, yeah, which I disagree with, but, yeah, I'm not going to judge them. Kinda. They got $16 million. They can deal with my judgment, okay? So, here's my point. Did they do anything to deserve $16 million? Not a thing. They did not inherit, they did not receive that inheritance based on any performance. You receive an inheritance based on who you are. It's a birthright. It's a birthright. As we prepare to close this morning, we were talking about the Lion King, Simba. Simba was lied to by his enemy about his identity, and because he believed the lie, he went on the run and nearly lost his birthright. If you watch the rest of the movie, he nearly lost his birthright. By the way, this would be a great movie to sit down and watch with your kids and kind of explain like some of this. It'd be a great picture with that. But church, if you are in Christ, listen, you've been, what the Bible says, you are born again. If you are in Christ, you have a re-birthright. Each one of us, we have a re-birthright. And just like Simba, you are an heir to the throne as a child of the king. And in Luke chapter 15, Jesus tells a story of someone who almost forfeited their birthright. It's the story of the prodigal son. And if you've been around church for a while, you may be familiar with the prodigal son. If not, that's okay. The prodigal son, for those of you that aren't familiar, this prodigal son, there was these two sons, and the younger one, the Bible says, or Jesus says it, that the younger one went to his dad and says, I want my inheritance. Like, I want it now. I want it now. Imagine that from a young child. I want it now. So the dad gave him his inheritance, and the son then packs up everything that he had, and he left his dad's house, and he went out to a foreign country and starts to just live wildly. Like crazy stuff, like PG-13, like we're not going to talk about it in church, like type things. But he wastes all of his money there, all of a sudden they get hit with this severe famine, like in this region. And he begins to struggle. The Bible says that he ends up getting a job like feeding pigs. He ends up feeding pigs, and Jesus in the story says that he was so hungry that he began looking at what the pigs were eating and literally dreamed of like filling his belly with his pig slop. Like that's how hungry this guy was. And then all of a sudden he didn't realize, he had this epiphany, he had this moment where he then realized that even his dad's servants like we're living better than him. So he concocts this plan. He's going to go back and he's going to talk to his dad. Like, so he practices his speech and he's getting ready to go back and talk to his dad. And this is what it says in verse 18. Here's the plan. He says, I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and he went to his father. Now, before we get into what next, let me ask you a question. Have you ever been there? Like, you ever been there? Have you ever made some, like, really, really, really dumb decisions and ended up in a place that you know you were not meant to be? Right? Like many of us, most of us, all of us, if we tell the truth. Here's what the Spirit of God said to me through this story. Listen, the prodigal son, he was right. He was right. Like he wasn't worthy to be called his father's son. He's right. But even with that, here's the truth. He never stopped being his father's son. He never stopped being his father's son. That was his identity. But he wasted his inheritance and he ends up eating garbage, listen, which was the wages of his decisions, because we have free will. Some of us are feasting on garbage in our lives right now. That is your free will. But what happened when he remembered whose he was? When he remembered who he was, let's see, he's trying to work his way back in as just a lowly servant, but his dad wasn't having that, even though that's what he deserved, he wasn't having that. And so we then learn, like in the next verse, it says that his dad saw him from a distance and ran. His dad, not yet, his dad ran to him, and I'm like, oh yeah, he ran. I'd be running too. I'd be like, if I saw a kid took and live wildly and probably look like and smelled like, you know, what he's going to be smelling like. And like the parental instinct kicks in. I'm thinking, oh, I'm going to go running. Like, boy, I'm going to tell you something. Like, first of all, where's my money? Where's my money? Where's my money? No, I wouldn't do that. It's my son. So don't call a hotline. Okay. I said, boy, where's my money? And because like this is the ultimate I told you so moment. Like the ultimate I told you so moment. So what happened? What happened next? Here we go. Verse 20. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Verse 21, the son, he then goes into the speech. The son says to his father, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on. He put a ring on his fingers and sandals on his feet. Bring in the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he's found. It's time to celebrate. See, we concoct this plan of I got to go back, you know, with my dauber down. I got to go back and be like, God, I messed up again. Listen, he ain't having that. He's like, you are my child. It's time to celebrate. You're starting to realize who it is that you really are. And so this is the delight of the Father. That's all the Father wanted, was the love of his Son. And so we pay the price for the love of a Son, just like what Jesus has done for us. And so they celebrated. They celebrated. And I want to point out a couple things here of this story. One of them is I think it's pretty obvious, and the other maybe a little bit subtle, but when the Son gets home, listen, there are some obvious needs. When the Son shows up, there's some obvious things that needs to be addressed. One of which, we know he was starving. So what did Dad do? He fed him. He was starving. So Dad feeds him. He was shoeless. Why? Because his dad put sandals on him. Like, get him sandals. I believe that his clothes were probably worn to rags, because from the type of work that he was doing and the extreme conditions of living in that region under the famine. So what did his dad do? Put the robe on him. Clothing. He took care of these like basic needs, like instantly. But there's one thing that Jesus did, said that the Father did, that might not stick out as much to you as it jumped off the page to me as I was reading this story. Jesus said he put a ring on his finger. He put a ring on his finger. Now, church, if I'm naked and I'm shoeless, and if I'm filthy and stanky and I'm starving, I'm so hungry that I was dreaming about eating these like pig pods, which sounds really gross. Like, I was dreaming about eating those. Listen, can I tell you, the last thing that's going through my mind is, man, I hope I get some bling. Like, no, not at all. So why is this so significant? Well, because the ring had tremendous meaning. The giving, don't miss this, the giving of the ring was the granting of authority to a person. You ever seen like one of those movies or shows where the king and they're like, kiss the ring? Because of what the ring represented. By the way, I've never seen those kind of movies because all I do is read the Bible. But listen. Rusty told me about it. But anyway. Well, listen. Whoever has such a ring has the power of attorney for the master. In other words, if you have the ring, if you read the ring, like he has the authority, he has his master's authority to make decisions and to help the master govern his realm. That's what the ring symbolizes. And so when the Father places the ring on the hand of a son, he not only welcomes his son back as a son, which was indicated by the robe and all the other things that he did, he welcomed him back to his authority. Why is that so important? I said earlier that if you're in Christ, you went from slave to adopted to a son or daughter, to indwelled by the very presence of God, to an heir. And some of us have fallen for the lie that because of past mistakes, current thoughts or behavior, secret struggles or addictions, I swore I'd never run back to the bottle, and yet here I am. I swore I'd never go back to those websites, and yet here I am. I knew that the Holy Spirit told me I needed to not go to that teacher's lounge where everybody's doing this, and gossip and the tearing people down and the here I am. I need to get into the Word. I need to do those things, get off social media. But here I am. It's an addiction. Some of us are trading the truth about our identity and the authority that that identity brings. We're trading it for a lie. The prodigal son almost gave up his birthright, listen, not because of his mistakes. The prodigal son almost gave up his birthright because he believed the lie that his mistakes disqualified him from his birthright. If you are in Christ, you have birthright. A huge part of that birthright is the abundant plan that God has for your life. Holy Spirit has a dream for your existence. And He wants to empower you to be able to live that abundant life that He has for you. Not because you're worthy, but because you're His. Let's pray this morning.
You know, the birthright that Pastor Will is talking about literally comes from us just receiving Christ. And so if you say, I don't know if I have that birthright, I don't know if I belong, I'm not sure. This morning, we can settle that. And that birthright can be yours when you walk out of this place, that you never have to wonder again, I wonder if I belong. I wonder if I deserve the ring, because it's all about what Jesus did and not about what we do. So if that is you and you're like, I don't know if I have that, I think I need the birthright. I need to receive Christ so that I can have that. So if that is you and you're like, I need that, just raise your hand and I will see it and we will pray. If there's anybody here who says, I need that, I need the birthright. Amen. Amen. As Pastor Will was sharing, and you can open your eyes and look back up here. As he was sharing, I saw this picture in my mind, and it was a bead necklace, but the beads weren't those little plastic, you know, there's those little colorful plastic beads that little kids play with, mostly girls, I guess. So, but it wasn't like that. It was fat beads that were wooden, and they were different sizes, and they were different colors. So I saw this necklace, I guess for lack of another term, of these big wooden beads. And so I just started to ask the Lord, what does this mean? I don't know what you're trying to say. And I felt in my spirit, like, this is what He said. You have collected beads or mementos from your past, from victories and successes and failures and mistakes and even victimizations. You've unknowingly positioned them on a chain that you wear around your neck like an adornment. Now you recognize that these reminders of your own shortcomings are choking the breath from you. You see that these beads need to be removed, but you can't imagine how to take them off without completely dislodging everything. And the thought of emptying everything out is so scary, you just walk around with the beads. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a metaphor. It's a metaphor. The beads aren't beads. The beads are things that are hanging on to you. And the thought of like laying everything out is terrifying. So I said, Lord, how do we deal without just taking the necklace off and letting everything fall to the floor? And then I saw in my mind, I saw like this mallet that was just hitting these wooden beads, and they were just disintegrating. That is the grace of God. That is not us striving. That's not me hammering. That is the grace of God who says, these things don't belong here. Let me get rid of these for you. I will do for you what you cannot do for yourself. Amen. I think there are some of us here who are walking around with things, and they may not be things that you talk about every day, or things that you want to show the world, but you know when you look in the mirror, you see these things hanging on you. And they're reminders of your failures. And God says, I want you to build reminders of my goodness. He told the Israelites as they walked through the desert, set a stone of remembrance, not for what they did, but for what he did. When he was faithful, he said, hey, put a good rock there and you'll remember. That's where I showed up. That's what God wants us to remember, is his goodness. And so if that is you and you say, you know what? I know what some of those beads are. I have some of those beads in my life that I look at, and there are days that they're choking the life out of me. And sometimes I'm placing my identity in those failures, just like Pastor Will said. I am getting my identity from things that were done to me and choices that I didn't even make, but someone else made. And Holy Spirit today says we need to smash some beads in your life. And so I would say, if that is you this morning, don't leave here without doing this. He's bringing you, like he's saying, Do you see this? I want to do this for you. Please let me do this for you. And don't be so afraid of being exposed that you miss it. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. It's not worth it to continue to carry it around. Please, please come and let us agree with you and watch what Holy Spirit wants to do, because he wants to give you victory, because that's who he is. Amen? Amen. So if you'll stand, I just want to pray and then bless you. And if the ministry team will go ahead and come. And so if you have that need, please do not leave here. So I'm going to do something that I forgot to do earlier. It's kind of an odd time to do it, but I don't want to leave without doing it. So we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Pastor Will. Yes, yes. Yeah. So we'll sing Happy Birthday, and then I will pray and just give a blessing. So don't go until after I get to bless you. So for you, Pastor Will.
Happy birthday.
Amen. Amen. We are grateful. We are grateful for all of you that were here this morning and just want to pray blessings over you. So in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the work that you are doing in this place. I thank you for reminding people of their identity and who you say that they are. God, let us look in a mirror and see your faithfulness. And not turn away and forget what we look like, not turn away and forget who we are, but that you would continue to remind us who you are, in the name of Jesus. So I just want to pronounce a blessing. So if you want this, all you got to do is hold out your hand. It doesn't have to be way out here. It can be anywhere. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. and cause his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you. May he look you right in the face and give you peace. In his name, amen. Amen. You're dismissed.
So guys, thank you again for checking out this video this morning. We pray that it blessed you. Hey, listen, if we can be a blessing to you in any way, feel free to reach out to us, onechurchwhitesboro.org. You can send us an email. We would love to pray for you and join you, just praying over anything that you may have, any ministry needs, or be able to answer any questions for you about what a walk with Jesus looks like and to help you discover who it is that God says that you be in his kingdom. Guys, until next time, be blessed.